Welcome to Living Well Church Online. I'm Stephen. This is my buddy Jason over here. And it's worship time. We're going to sing all of our heart, soul, and strength to a God that's deserving of our worship, our adoration, our fear. The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom. So, Lord, we just come to you this morning. We thank you, God, for your grace in our life that is something beyond that what we can truly understand. We were dead in our sins, and you called us to life. And we thank you for that. We're here to sing these songs to you, Lord, to your heart. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
In my heart, it glows like a river it flows. The strength of your love, like a mighty rushing flood, washing over me with healing and majesty, until all I can do is minister back to you. Juve. vine, full of virtue that shines with the strength of your Son. Our God, three in one, how you burn in me. You are the air I breathe. Help me heal back my life so you would be magnified.
Scars and struggles on the way, but
Jesus, our hearts can say.
By your Holy Spirit, as we draw near, we want to know you, we want to learn, we want to grow, so we come under, Lord. Now teach us, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Hello, my name is Joan Rood. I'm from El Paso, Texas. Number 624 says, "The Lord bless you and keep you." I was playing a game called Ungame with Pastor Arlen and Mrs. Barbara Steen when John Rood, my husband, and I were on vacation with them. One of the cards I drew quoted this scripture and then asked the question, "How has God blessed you?" I have been giving to the Lord for many years, and there are many blessings I can count that God has given me. But I want to share a particular blessing with you that involves Barbara Steen. Prior to this vacation, I had only heard about her from Pastor Arlen and my husband. I eagerly waited meeting her, and it was finally going to happen. The first day we met, she told me she wanted to bless me by taking me with her to the spa and having tea time with her. How many people would do that for someone they had never met? I was fairly shy about meeting her, but she made me feel comfortable and I went with her. Now that I've spent some time with her, I can say that she is not only fun, but very sweet and kind and a very giving person. She is the real deal. Many times when you're faithful to give to God, He blesses you in a way other than simply financially. Many times His blessing is in the form of a friend. I count Barbara to be my friend now, and I hope this friendship will continue and develop in a closer way. So the scripture that says, "The Lord bless you and keep you," I speak over Pastor Allen and Barbara. May the Lord bless you and keep you.
Welcome to the online service of Living Well Church. Keep in mind that we're an online church on Rumble and YouTube, but we're also a local church, and we meet in Syracuse, Utah. Now, Syracuse is about 25 miles north of Salt Lake City, right off of I-15. So please visit our website at lwcvc.org for more information about our online church, our local church, and just information about, you know, our team, biographies, statement of purpose and vision and so forth. There's a lot on there. So avail yourself of that. Now, as we begin today, there is a story Luke records about a woman who had a spirit of infirmity. She was in church on the Sabbath listening to him. And the thing about her is that she was bent over and could not stand up straight. She'd been this way for 18 years. Well, when Jesus saw her, he called her to him and just said to her, "Woman, you're loose from your infirmity." And then he laid hands on her, and immediately the Bible says she was made straight, and she began praising God there in church. Some people don't like that. Well, that's when the leaders of the synagogue got into it with Jesus. They upbraided him for healing on the Sabbath day. But he unveiled their complete hypocrisy because they would loose their ox or their donkey if they got stuck in the mud or fell in a hole on the Sabbath and didn't think a thing of it. Well, then he also identified the source of this woman's issue. And this is what I want to really bring out and emphasize. He said, when he was talking to them about this woman, he said, "Whom Satan has bound." Think of it, for 18 years. She'd been bound for 18 years. She's been over. She couldn't, raise herself up. And he says Satan had bound her. And that's true today. Sickness and disease comes from Satan. Actually, I like what someone said that, sickness is the foul offspring of its father Satan, I believe they said, in the mother sin. So, it comes because of Satan's influence in the world, but also because of how sin was introduced into the world. Now, Berkeley Version, says that she was healed from a weakening spirit. Satan has all kinds of different spirits that can, influence our bodies, our health, and so forth. Smith Goodspeed said, "Had a sickness caused by a spirit." Now, that does not mean that all sickness and disease is caused by an evil spirit. But in this case, the Bible identifies that it was. And the Simple English Bible says, "This woman whom I healed is our Jewish sister. But Satan has held her for 18 years. Why can't she be untied from her sickness on the Sabbath day?" That's what I want you to see and hear and understand. Just as you might be on the prowl, so to speak, to watch out for maybe a moral failure, you don't want to do that. Or maybe you're really watching your tongue so that you don't curse and cuss and say all kinds of foul language. Other people, have to be on the alert where maybe strong drink and alcohol is concerned because there's a tendency there for them to overdo it. Or maybe they came from an alcoholic home and saw devastation and so forth. There's certain things that we seem to be sensitive to and will stand against. Well, just as you might be sensitive to different types of sin and you're real sensitive to stand against them, you need to be the same way where sickness is concerned. The first time you go, or the first time, you have to use a Kleenex, recognize that behind all that, even though it just may be physical, they'll say it's the flu season, it's the cold season, and, take this or take that. Recognize that you need to take a stand against it. You need to resist it just as if Satan himself were trying to put that on you. That's what I want you to see today. Let's pray. Father, I thank you in the name of Jesus for the enlightenment of your word and the opportunity to pray. And I lift up every person who's watching this at this moment that they would get the revelation that Jesus is the healer, Satan is the destroyer. Satan is the oppressor. Jesus is the deliverer. And I pray right now for the healing of every person, dear Lord, who is sick and who is reaching out in your name, in faith. They're exercising their faith. We break the power of the devil over their bodies, over their minds, over their relationships. It doesn't matter if it is a sickness. It doesn't matter if it is a condition like this lady had for 18 years. It can be a prolonged thing. It does not matter. We break its power in Jesus' name, and we pronounce healing to the people. Holy Spirit, I believe your anointing is going forth now to do a great work in the lives and the bodies of the people. And I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. The last time we were together, I shared how Jesus taught Dad Hagen that it was our, the believer's, responsibility to exercise authority over the devil in the earth. I shared how, when he had the open vision in 1952, that as Jesus was telling him these things, a little demon got between them and began yelling, "Yakety-yak! Yakety-yak! Yakety-yak!" And then he somehow sprayed a dark cloud between them, so not only could Dad Hagen not see Jesus, he could no longer hear him either. And he finally got so frustrated because he was missing what Jesus was saying. And then realized Jesus himself wasn't going to do anything about it. So he did. He commanded that devil to be quiet and then to leave the room. And he did. Now, after this took place, Jesus knew he had questions and told him if he had not done something about that, he could not have, meaning he himself could not have. Well, Brother Hagen went back and forth with him four times on this because he was just sure Jesus had meant to say, "I would not have." But Jesus insisted, "No, I said I could not have done anything about it." Now, there's a huge difference in being willing or not willing, which would not have would indicate, to being unable to, which could not have would indicate. And Jesus said it was the latter. I could not have done anything about that demon if you hadn't. I did not say I would not. I said I could not. Jesus could not do anything about that little demon. Wow. Well, this may be so stunning to you that I thought it wise to take another week to talk about the reality of authority on earth in a message I've titled, True Humility. Now, we need to wake up and realize we are the ones that have authority in the earth. We must change our way of thinking first so we can change the way we pray and change the way we sing. The Bible tells us that we are sitting at the right hand of the Father, far above all principalities and powers. If we're far above them, then we have authority over them. Listen to what Paul goes on to say in Ephesians chapter 1, verses 22 and 23. I'm reading this from the New King James Version. "And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all." Now, he said he put principalities and powers under his feet. Well, the feet are members of the body of Christ. Feet aren't members of the head. As John A. McMillan pointed out, how wonderful to know that the least members of the body of Christ, those who are the very soles of the feet, the little toenail or the little toe, are far above the mighty forces we have been considering. Yet, if you listen to the average Christian talk or hear some preachers preach, you'd get the impression that the devil is bigger than everybody and that he's in charge of and running everything. Well, he is the god of this world, and so he is running the world system. But here's the key. We are in this world, but guess what? We're not of this world. This means he has no authority to run us. And yet most Christians have allowed the devil to walk on them way too long. And this may be illustrated by something you may have heard somewhere along the line. It goes like this: I've got the devil on the run. The trouble is, I'm running and he's after me. Well, that statement, or statements that are similar to it, is absolutely ridiculous and is not what the Bible says. Notice in James chapter 4, verse 7, I'm reading from the New King James Version. It says this: resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Now, the Greek word translated resist is also used in Ephesians 6:13, where it says, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. So we see that not only will we be able to withstand the attacks of the devil, but we'll even put him on the run. This is the New Testament perspective and understanding of the place the believer has on the earth. Now, this totally debunks phrases, statements, and questions we've heard through the years, such as, I don't know why the Lord permitted that. If it was God's will, she would have been healed. If God heals, he heals for good. Here I wander like a beggar through the heat and the cold. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. Precious Jesus, don't forget me. Standing somewhere in the shadows, you'll find Jesus. Lord, build me a cabin in the corner of glory. When that little child died, it was because God wanted another rose for his garden. If you are ever going to walk in the authority on earth that Jesus transferred to you, you must, this is pretty graphic, but you must flush all of that garbage that is represented by those statements down the toilet. As a member of the body of Christ, you are in the position of authority. Jesus, as he told Dad Hagen and in the verses he shared with him, has already done everything he's going to do about the devil. If he's defeated, what more is there for him to do? Not a thing. So now it's up to you to exercise the authority God gave you. See, we as Christians must learn that we are seated with Christ. And this is not some positional truth looked at theologically. It is spiritual reality now. And so we must learn to be exalted to the place where God has put us and wants us to be. In Ephesians chapter 1, verses 22 and 23, it said, "And he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all things to the church." Jesus is head over sickness, disease, and anything else that's evil, as he proved when he was here on earth. Now let's reverse the words in this phrase, as it may bring out the meaning just a little more clearly for you. I want to change this. If you have your Bible, follow along and watch the change, and then think about it this way. "And gave him to be head to the church over all things." Let me say that again. "And gave him to be head to the church over all things." In other words, Jesus is head over all things for the church's sake. Now, I can hear the religious-minded arguing this is being lifted up in pride, and that this does not exhibit true Christian humility to think that we have authority over the devil and we're seated at the right hand of the Father and that we can alter our circumstances by praying or by the confession of our mouth. Well, let's tackle that head on with Scripture. Let's go back to James chapter 4, verse 7, but read all of it. Verse 7 says, "Therefore, submit to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you." Now, the placement of the devil fleeing from you comes after the phrase submitting to God. Submitting to God has at least two applications. First, it is submitting to the written word of God. If you submit yourself to the written word of God, are you not submitting to God? I think you are, obviously. And second, it is submitting to the spoken word of God in your heart. In other words, when God speaks to you in your heart, or he witnesses something to your heart, or you get a leading from him in your heart. How are you going to make the devil flee, as that verse said, "Resist the devil and he will flee from you," if you don't do something to make him flee? You know he's not just going to go wandering off on his own. This does not say the devil is going to flee from Jesus. Did you notice that? It says he's going to flee from you. Yeah, Y-O-U, you and me. There's got to be something he fears in you that makes him flee. What could that be? Well, how about, there's several things, but how about the shield of faith? When you operate in the arena of faith, Satan has no chance of defeating you. If he can get you in fear now, that's a different story. He can take you down. So you got to stay in faith. Keep the shield of faith raised. Something else. How about the confession of your lips? That's how your faith is primarily expressed, is through your lips. Now, think about David running his mouth as he ran towards Goliath, saying, "You are an uncircumcised Philistine, and you have no covenant with God, and I'm worshiping and, you know, trusting in and serving the true God, and I have a covenant with him." And he's doing this as he's running towards Goliath. Well, he was running his mouth as he was running towards the enemy. And after he got Goliath, guess what? All the Philistines fled. That's exactly what James said the devil will do if you resist him. I believe David's experience was a shadow of the New Testament believer. Circumstances comes against us and looks so big and so tall and so strong and so immovable, and it looks like doomsday is here. But if you'll go running towards that circumstance, what have you, with the Word of God in your mouth, you're submitting to God, you're resisting the devil, and he will flee. Now, you're not convinced about this. Well, let's go down a few verses to in James 4 to verse 10. Here's what it says. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Humble yourselves. Okay, we're talking about true humility. That's really our topic here today. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Now, here's the humbling, and here's the lifting. I want you to notice the Greek word translated humble is also used in Matthew chapter 18, verse 4. Now, this is Jesus speaking. He says, therefore, whoever humbles himself as this little child, he had a little child in his presence and used this child in an illustration, is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven. You know you've read that verse, you've heard it. The greatest in heaven is as this little child. Now, according to Strong's Concordance, this word humble literally means to make low. Metaphorically, the word means to debase, to lower oneself. So it describes a person who is devoid of all arrogance and self-exaltation. This is a person who is willingly submitted to God and his will. Now, if I were to ask you today, were you one of these people? Are you submitted to God and his will? If you're a Christian, if you're a believer, and you have some sense of seriousness about your walk with God, I think you'd probably say, yeah, I am. Well, here's two observations. First, Jesus used a little child to illustrate humility. Now, little children are completely void of pride, and they're totally dependent upon parents. Their position is humility. When dad or mom says something, they usually do it. I know there's the exception, but, little children usually obey their mom. Now, they may cry, they may be kicking and screaming, but really, they have no choice. But within time, usually, they will obey. Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir. Second, true humility in believers is the very same thing. When Father God says something, the humble will bow to that. This is good. If he says, I've been raised together with Christ, then guess what? I must humble myself before him and say, yes, Lord. If he says, I've been seated with Christ at the Father's right hand, then I must humble myself before him and say, yes, Lord. If he says, I've been healed by the stripes placed on Jesus' back, then I must humble myself before him and say, yes, Lord. If he says, I'm a new person in Christ, and that all things have passed away, then I must humble myself before him and say, yes, Lord. If he says, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ, then I must humble myself before him and say, yes, Lord. Because if I have a childlike heart to God, and I walk in faith following God, just like a little child believes what his father or his mother says, then I must humble myself and say, yes, Lord. Now, you may not feel any of these things. You may not be convinced of them or even believe them. But now at this point, if you recognize that submitting yourself to God is done primarily in two ways, submitting to what his word says or submitting to what God's word to you in your heart says, the spoken word, then you'll see that you have to obey and be convinced of it in order to exhibit humility before God. But now, it's really your choice. Because everything that I mentioned there in the end verse, you know, not believing that it's God's will to heal you, not believing you're the righteousness of God in Christ, not believing all these other things, you know what that is? That's pride. Because God in His wisdom and God in His knowledge and God in what He's done in the work on the cross now declares in the Bible, this is what's true about you. So it's your choice to rise up in pride and say what you believe, or bow low in humility and say what God says about you. Now, I realize that if you've been raised in church and you've never heard things like this, it can be difficult to absorb that. It took time. It was difficult for me to absorb the fact that Jesus had already taken my sicknesses upon Himself. And it was always His will that I either be healed or, better yet, just walk in health without sickness and disease. It was a little hard to realize that in God's eyes, I am the righteousness of God in Christ. I'm not just some kind of a sinner still, saved by grace, but still a sinner. That's an oxymoron. No, I had to humble myself and come to the conclusion that if God said it, it must be true. And I had to humble myself and receive these truths into my life. So what we need to do as individuals coming into these things is meditate upon these verses so that our spirit may fully understand them. And once we do, we'll reap rich rewards. When we have this reverent attitude towards God and His Word, the Spirit of Truth, the Holy Spirit, can lift us into a place where we can see the true meaning of God's revelation. You remember there in James, he said, resist the devil and he will flee from you. Humble yourselves before the Lord and He will lift you up. Well, in Ephesians, Paul prayed that the church at Ephesus also might have this spirit of wisdom and revelation. God made Christ to be the head over all things to the church. It is for our sake that He's the head, so that we through Him might exercise that authority over all things. And when we understand what belongs to us, we will enjoy the victory Christ has for us. The devil will fight to keep us from getting there, but through stubborn faith in Christ, the victory can be ours. Now, I want you to know something else. There is no stronghold, no addiction, no habit, no bondage that can keep you from coming into a relationship with Jesus. All you have to do is exercise your will and say to yourself, say to the devil or anyone else, I'm giving my life to the Lord, and you cannot stop me. We're going to have a song, and then we're going to pray a prayer that will bring you into the kingdom of God. I invite you to join us in saying this prayer and come to Jesus.
Let's all sing together the old hymn, What a Friend We Have in Jesus.
What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and grief to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. grace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear. All because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Trials and temptation, is there trouble anywhere? We should never be discouraged. Take it to the Lord in prayer. Find a friend so faithful who will all our sorrows share. Jesus knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in prayer. We weak and heavy laden, cumbered with a load of care. Precious Savior, still our refuge, take it to the Lord in prayer. Friends despise, forsake thee. Take it to the Lord in prayer. In his arms he'll take and shield thee. Thou wilt find a solace there. We'll find a solace there.
Dear God in heaven, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe he is your son and that he died for me. His shed blood cleanses me from all sin. I believe he arose from the dead. I confess him as my Savior and Lord. According to your word, I'm now born again and going to heaven.
If you prayed that prayer from your heart, you are now a new person in Christ. The Bible says so. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, send us a comment, or go to our website and contact us at the email listed there. Website is lwcvc.org. That's lwcvc.org. The email address is info@lwcvc.org. We can send you some materials to help you get started in walking with God. We'd love to do so. Now, as we close the service, let's close with the Aaronic blessing. Get ready. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.
I've got peace like a river. I've got love like an ocean. I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got peace in my mind. A river. I've got love like an ocean. I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got peace like a river in my soul. Ah, oh, I love like an ocean in my soul. I've got peace like a river. I've got love like an ocean. I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got peace in my mind. A river, I've got love like an ocean. I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got peace like a river in my soul.
Peace like a river.
Love like an ocean in my soul. Joy like a fountain in my soul. Peace, love, and joy in my soul.
Oh,